Hi, I'm Mike and welcome to Aircrew Interview. Chris Bolton is a former RAF and Royal Navy F-4 Phantom pilot. In this interview, he mainly focuses on his time with the Royal Navy, including what it was like to take off and land on a carrier, the ship's accommodation, and also some personal stories. Also, please visit our website at aircrewinterview.tv to sign up to our newsletter to receive exclusive footage and bonus material. Also, visit patreon.com/aircrewinterview to become a member of the team. Enjoy.
So, Chris, when did you become interested in aviation?
I guess nearly all the time. My early childhood was in South Africa, and my father had been an RAF pilot in World War II and left almost immediately the war was over. But then the Korean War came up, so as an infant we came back to UK. My father rejoined the RAF, retrained, refreshed as a pilot, if you like. And my very first trip was with him from the beautiful Luton Airport in an Oster, the mark I can't remember. But anyway, up we went round the local area there. I really enjoyed the experience.
What year did you join the RAF?
February 64.
And could you tell us a bit about the process back then?
The process as in the recruiting?
Yeah.
The recruiting was back to Biggin Hill, whereas the private pilots thing for the flying scholarship had been, I think, 2 days. I think it was about 3 days of much the same, but things like leadership exercises at Biggin Hill. From memory, loads of us joined on day one at Biggin, and each day that went by, there were less people there. You never heard what happened to them, they just failed to go on to the next evolution. That was it. I guess, only guessing, 2 or 3 weeks after the experience, I got a letter saying I'd been accepted, and then joining instructions to go to number one initial training school, which is South Cerny in Gloucestershire. And that was joining the Air Force. The ITS, I was there a long time because I injured a knee on the assault course and had the great fortune and experience, broadening of mind to go to Headley Court to recover. Headley's well known now because of it's a joint services place for injured, mainly from places like Afghanistan. That was excellent. Headley Court, there a month. Wednesday nights, they provided us transport, took us up to London, we'd see a show, have a few beers, etc. That was the Air Force, and I knew I'd made the right move. Anyway, after leaving Headley, I was fit like a robber's dog, and it's because every day, all day, was physical exercise. South Cerny was a breeze, leadership exercise, running up and down hills, either on restrictions or voluntarily. And graduated from the initial training school and off to number 2 FTS at RAF Syerston in Nottinghamshire, where, when we were issued our QFIs, I met one who you've already interviewed, Rick Groombridge, a young Rick Groombridge in those days, but there we go. The basic flying finished for me in late 65, and then off to Valley. I went to 4 FTS on the NAT. Our choices then from basic school had been, it was selected, either the fast jet, which was Valley, the heavier stuff, which was Oakington on varsities, or for some, rotary wing at Turnhill. Not much to say about Valley, great fun, horse riding on the beach, good pubs, etc., etc., an enjoyable experience. The aeroplane, the NAT, I suppose would be one of my favourites. Very high performance, very small, very manoeuvrable, exhilarating after the Jet Provost or anything else I'd flown. After I'd done the QFI stuff at Syerston, Hunters were my next aeroplane. I was sent down to join at Chivenor in North Devon, and the particular training squadron I was on was 63. Excellent stuff, because it seemed a little bit more grown up than other things I'd been involved with, and something of a beast to fly and also to use as an aeroplane, because now, having done the initial bit of the course there, learning to fly the aeroplane, getting the instrument rating, we did the weaponry, close formation stuff, low-level navigation, excellent staff. I seem to remember it was about 70 hours, most of the low flying around Devon, Cornwall and Wales. Great fun. After that, we went our separate ways. Some of the people on the course went on to Lightnings, and they'd been doing what was known as a pre-Lightning course. Others of us went on to dedicated hunter squadrons, of which there were not many left. There were the two in Bahrain by this stage, and one, the remnants of one, still left in Singapore. That was 20 Squadron. And, oh, there was the recce squadrons in Germany. End of it, the rest of them had closed down. The Hunter Squadron, there wasn't a lot to do in Bahrain in terms of operational usage of the aircraft. I was keeping an eye on the Iranians. That doesn't seem to change, inasmuch as they would creep out at night from Iranian shore and put flags up on a couple of islands called Tumb and Abu Musa. And we used to go out, just report the fact there was a flag or there wasn't a flag, and then someone would do whatever was appropriate. The Saudis at one stage got a bit uppity and wanted lots of the action involving oil round about Bahraini Oasis. So we would back up the various truceful governments, as they were in those days, by showing the flag and, in fact, flying around in Saudi at low level, looking at what the Saudis were up to and hoping we weren't caught. But there was an inside conduit. There's a British mercenary pilot flying Lightnings who would tell us what they were up to and where their aeroplanes would be going. So we never saw them. But in terms of writing things in a logbook in green ink, that was it for me on the Hunter Squadron. On completion, our postings varied, going to Lightnings, some went to Harriers, which were then new aircraft. Sorry about my phone going off like this. Phantoms, of course, and Buccaneers. Jaguars hadn't come along by this stage. Mine was Phantom FGR-2. All that meant at the time was that it wasn't the air defence version, which was F-4K FG-1. And to Coningsby. I think it was about a six-month course. The first half of the course was the air defence stuff, which was all new and not particularly popular with us hunter guys, who preferred low-level ground attack, high speed, etc., etc. But that was over soon enough. And then on to 2 Squadron of the OCU to learn the weapons. The weapons used then was the 20mm cannon, SNEB rocket, 68mm rockets, and we drop smoke and flash bombs, either 4 or 5 pounds or 28-pounders, I can't remember. I think the 28-pounder simulated 1,000-pounders. The little one simulated retarded 1,000-pounders. Back then, and I'm going back just over 40 years, there were no such things as accurate bombs other than our skill itself. It was good if you could get a 1,000-pounder within 30 feet of the target. It was very good because of the wind, lack of aiming ability in the aircraft, even though we had inertial weapons aiming, it left a lot to be desired. The inertial in these Phantom aircraft was analog. So the guy in the back, to wind this thing up, it took 30 minutes to wind up at the beginning of the day, you actually physically drove a lever forward and aft, left and right, for lat and long and north and south sort of stuff. Quite primitive. And you get 2 mile terminal errors on this, so not very good. You could update it at low level. But for most of us, of course, we carried a map. And the low-level stuff, no great challenges. Very little going high-level, other than to transit between low-flying areas. So from the OCU, those of us who'd done this ground attack phase, more than half went to Germany on the nuclear squadrons there, 14, 17 and 31 at Bruggen. Some of us went to 6 and 54 at Coningsby, and a couple to 41, which was recce. And I think 2 Squadron had come into recce then by Phantom, yeah, in Germany. I did the next 2 years on 6 Squadron, which I have to say was really good fun, good bosses, excellent role for the young bachelor, loads of detachments, and joining the squadron about the first evolution to help with these detachments was air-to-air refueling, which one of the guys at the time, my QFI from the OCU, had referred to us. They briefed us on the OCU. It's like taking a running fuck at a rolling donut. And to some extent, that did define the thing, because the closer you got, the more you over-controlled and missed. The secret, of course, was to calming down a bit and not staring at the basket and letting the guy in the back seat tell you up and down a little bit left to right, etc., to get the probe to go into the basket. Once mastered, it was okay. It became more difficult on operational deployments, etc., where some of the longer flights we'd be taking off at midnight, and the air-to-air refueling could often be not only dark, but in cloud and turbulent. That made it exciting. The guy in the back drove us in pretty damn close on the radar, which is a nice piece of kit for the day. And as soon as you were visual with the tanker, on you went, took your fuel. The longest we did this air-to-air refueling for on the 6th Squadron, when I was there, was to go to Singapore. The first Singapore deployment had been with 54, and they'd done it in one go. I think one guy did it in 14 hours and 50 minutes. Now, that's not bad, considering I had an apple, a packet of crisps, and a flask of squash. Imagine the domestic details of the obscene groping required to have a pee, etc., etc. Anyway, it was done. Quite boring to keep flying for that long. I only did about 8 hours, because we split it up by flying either into Dubai or Missouri, and then another crew who'd already pre-positioned would take it on, and we'd reverse it coming back. The detachments were 6 to 8 weeks from leaving Coningsby, and Singapore, landing there, the first cold beer really did taste good. We worked with the Australian and New Zealand Air Forces, the Singapore forces, which were starting to build up in those days. Excellent. I have to say, I can remember one of the flights, the aforementioned Missouri. I landed there after the flight from UK, and the guy in the back would call out distance to run as you touched down, put the brake chute out. He'd say 6,000 feet to go, 120 knots. Well, he said 5,000 to go, 119 knots, or something like this. And the closer the end got, the less the speed seemed to have stopped. And at this point, I burst a tire. Okay, no major drama, aircraft stopped. The drama for me was over, but it got a little bit bigger. There was a Vulcan in the overhead. My aeroplane needed to be jacked up to change the wheel to tow it off. And as they jacked it up, the jack went through the runway and the aircraft didn't shift. That was quite a trick for them to lift up, because it was soft, the material of the runway and the loading, etc., etc. As a result of that, bursting the tire, I merited a bollocking when I got to Singapore. This took place in the boss's office, perhaps a week or so later. Okay, put my hand up, that was my error of braking. And the boss was determined to make a point of it. His office had a glass wall behind his desk. And so behind the boss and the other side of the glass wall were the rest of the squadron mates, all going, all this sort of stuff like that. Well, I got a bollocking and tried to keep a straight face. And the boss said, this is not funny. You know, and I'm sorry, boss, etc. Anyway, that was that. I think I got an orderly officer or something out of it. What I hadn't mentioned, part of the 6th Squadron end of my time there last year, we did self-illuminated night ground attack. This really was a thrill, sixpence half crown, for those of you who still remember Imperial measure, inasmuch as we built up to flying 5 aircraft in a magic flying circus to places like Jerby or Otterburn. Now, the aircraft were armed up with Leapus flares. The lead ship had 3 on each wing. The number 2 had 3 only, plus conventional weapons. Of course, we weren't doing nuke. And the remaining 3 had a mixture of rockets and bombs. So what happened, we went in a long line astern towards the target. The leader would pull up at about 2.5 miles, 4G pull. At 30 degrees, he would release the first of flare, 40 degrees the second flare, and 50 degrees the third flare. The flares were free flight for about 6 seconds, at which point they would open up on the end of a parachute and illuminate whatever it was the guy had pulled up to illuminate, not necessarily the correct target. Anyway, at that point, the remainder would pull up, judge the target and select the weapon they thought would best suit the occasion, the choice being a bomb or a rocket. Sometimes these flares were below you, they were ghosting depending on the visibility, i.e. flares were casting shadows around a goldfish bowl upon which we flew. Anyway, in we dived in turn with the appropriate weapon. Okay, so far so good, except when we came off target and tried to rejoin, it was difficult to know who the fuck was who. And many a shambles ensued and long debriefs, and no, it wasn't my fault, it was your fault sort of stuff. Typical fighter pilot debriefs. That's you, the non-deviating hand, and this is me, that type of thing. Anyway, that covers the Leapus night ground attack, and no, the boss did not get an Air Force cross, nor did he get any thanks from us who had to do this game. I suppose I was lucky in one way, because one of my secondary duties, I wrote the flying schedule for 6th Squadron. Just do the usual things, go to the flight commanders and the boss and say, when are you available, etc., etc., etc. And I always put myself on the night flying program, generally having checked with the engineers that there were only 4 aeroplanes, for example. I would be number 5. Not a fool. Towards the end, they were looking for people to go to the fleet air arm. Historically, the Royal Navy stopped training fixed-wing pilots in 1968, and they cancelled the new supercarrier they were going to get at that time. So, not training any fixed-wing pilots, they had to borrow. Borrowing from the US Navy was easy, because there was always people on loan service with the US Navy on East and West coasts. And so there would be 1 or 2 crews at the maximum from the US Navy. These were now augmented as people left the Navy after their short or medium service careers by volunteers from the Air Force. There were no pressed men. I was about number 4 to go along. There were 2 guys who'd gone from the Coningsby squadrons and another guy had gone from the Air Defence Squadron Lucas. It all sounded great fun to me. So I spoke to people in the bar, particularly navigators who'd done time with the Navy on Sea Vixens. The reason they'd been there is because the Phantom was going to come into service with the RAF and they lacked 2-seat air defence navigators. So putting them to the Navy got them the experience for the Phantom as it came into service. So for me, it was an easy decision to make. Yes, please, I'd like to go. No problems, I was Tour X anyway with 6th Squadron. The paperwork was all done, posting to Phantom training flight at Lucas. So there I am, finished that, off to Lucas to the Phantom training flight, run by the Navy. The boss was actually a squadron leader RAF, but he had previously been a Navy flyer. His father was Walker VC, a very famous guy in destroyers in World War II. Anyway, for me, the PTF wasn't learning to fly the aeroplane. I was already Phantom trained. It was learning to do things the Navy way, which were different, some of it significantly different, lesser fuel requirements to land. The way they did air intercepts was different, but I hadn't done many anyway, so I was open-minded to whatever they suggested. And the other bits to make me more navalized were doing the deck landings. So we'd practice this on the runway at Lucas, where they'd painted a dummy deck, and they'd put the deck landing projector sight beside the runway on the port side of the runway, that's left, by the way. And there we'd go and do MADLs, mirror-assisted dummy deck landing practice. And it was almost like the real thing. The only difference was that with the Phantom being a low wing, virtually delta, as you got in close, you hit ground effect. So you'd go high in close anyway. So that wasn't going to happen on board the ship. To back it up, having done that sort of stuff, more weaponry at sea, the Navy fighter squadron, 892 Phantoms, had secondary role with 2-inch rockets, not dissimilar to the 68mm SNEB, slightly less accurate perhaps, and more per pod, and bombs. So we did practice weaponry on Rose Hearty and Tain Rangers, which were handy for the Lucas area. Before going to sea, we were required to do catapult shots, for me, the first time ever. So this was achieved at RAE Bedford, where they had a steam catapult on a ramp. The ramp was probably 4 feet above an old disused short runway. So flew down to Bedford, the QFI in the back, myself in the front, taxi up onto the ramp, go and have a little bit of a briefing. The aircraft is on the ramp now, cocked, etc., ready to go, and then get in. It's fixed, of course, so the wind across the deck or across the ramp was whatever the wind was that day. They couldn't put it into wind, as is probably obvious. So if, for example, you had a tailwind, to achieve flying speed, you would get an almighty bloody kick, 5G or thereabouts. My day, not exciting. Wind was down the catapult, and so that was it. The catapult, they extend the nose leg, as people may appreciate, the nose leg on the Navy Phantoms extended pneumatically by 40 inches. So this gave an incidence of about 9 degrees to achieve not having to rotate so much at the end of the catapult shot or the takeoff run. So that's all done. You're at full flap, full afterburner, and the guy on the ground is waving a little flag at you, and you put a hand up. Yes, sir, I have power. The aircraft is serviceable, and he'll put his flag down. The guy who's in charge of the catapult acknowledges that. He's been sat there with his hands on his head so he doesn't inadvertently shoot the thing, and he's acknowledged it, so his hands go down and he fires the catapult. This is exactly the same as it's going to be on board the ship. Bang, off you go. That's a thrill. And so there you are, 1,000 feet, turn down wind, make an arrested landing on one of the runways, just a normal long runway, taxi back onto the catapult. And so 3 catapult shots made, and after the final one, fly straight back to Lucas. Whole evolution, 30 minutes on the ground at Bedford. Thrilling. Anyway, got the idea what to expect. What to expect from it? A couple of other things. It's been recently on one of the Facebook things. There's an item called SPD in the Navy Phantoms, Stick Positioning Device. Now, this is a little cylinder with a wire coiled around it. You declutch the cylinder and stick it into the back, the front of the stick, and hold it declutched until you've got the right angle on the stabilator, as witnessed by yourself with a gauge here and a guy down there telling you you have the right incidence for the aircraft to achieve a good transition from takeoff to climb position. Anyway, that was the only difference there. And release it once you're airborne. The stick was here, but what the idea was that the stick would not come back into your belly with the 4G or 5G shot, causing you to over rotate or whatever. Oh, the parachute is coming down. So that's it. Having done the catapult shots and all the medals to almost everyone's satisfaction, the last thing was a briefing from the LSO, landing site or landing safety officer. This is a chap called Peter Shepherd, famous in fleet air arm circles, still alive to this day, Sea Fury pilot in the Korean War, Vixens and so on, very tall, big bushy beard, a voice like that, you know, drank cider. And he came up to give me the horror stories. Now, this is what you can do wrong when making an approach to land on an aircraft carrier. And every takeoff and landing is filmed. So the horror shots were all there to illustrate the errors of other people's ways in the hopes that me, the new guy, wasn't going to fuck up similarly. There's a late lineup, wingtip touches the deck, aircraft goes over the side, all this sort of shit, too low, hitting the ramp, bits falling off. And you think, oh fuck, I really needed to see all this stuff. It's really boosted my confidence. Anyway, all that done, the next thing that happens, signed off at the PTF, and I'm going to go and join the ship. There's one guy who's slightly more nervous about this than myself, and that's my observer. Now, he's quite an experienced Vixen and Phantom observer, and he's going to have to sit in the back for my first catapult shot from the ship. Well, no drama there, because you go, there's nothing, it's out of your hands. Coming back is the bit where my judgment is going to make his day more exciting. Well, done all the PTF stuff, joining the ship for the first time, and I'm not joining by air, I'm joining by Jack Stay Transfer. Now, those of you who've seen the program Warship recently will have seen replenishment at sea. in effect, this is a tanker type boat to take furnace fuel oil and aviation fuel, goes into formation with the carrier alongside starboard side, fires a line over and a bigger line is pulled on, and then the fuel bits are pulled across as well to refuel the carrier. Well, I was on board this with my observer, and we were taken over on the end of the wire in a little cage called a jack stay, transferred to the carrier. This was in the morning of day one for me on Ark Royal. The remainder of the morning was up in FLICO, flying control, which is a on the island, sticks out over the flight deck, and it's the lair of Little F and Wings. Little F, Lieutenant Commander Flying, Wings, Commander Air. Anyway, great spot for the likes of me to go and observe what's happening, see the deck in operation for my afternoon flight. So watch all that stuff, get the briefs again, and I'm now going to go on my way. I go down to the ACRB, Air Crew Refreshment Bar, a little greasy spoon in the island superstructure where you can get a great bacon butty and a cup of tea. It's a super bit, missed that. Anyway, all briefed up. Our ready room or crew room is in the island as well. Looks like lots of secondhand airline seats to sit there, get the briefing. My trip is going to be an air intercept, high level radar type sortie, if you like. The exciting bit, which is the only thing in my mind at the time, was coming back an hour and 20 minutes later. Anyway, so walk out, man up the aeroplanes, and in our turns, the Buccaneers go off first because they're going to be airborne longer and they don't use fuel at the rate we do. So hence the logic of that. They'll go off first and come on last. And then it's our turn. So from my point of view, hands almost shaking, knees almost under control, taxi out. And what you're looking at is a guy, is a marshaler right in front of you. And once he's marshaled you forward, he'll point there. So you turn to the next marshaler on your way to the catapult. Now in my case, first time ever, they determined logically enough that I would go off the waist catapult. Why? The waist is long, 195 feet. The bow is very short. So, marshalled on, and the guy on the catapult's marshalling me, so nose wheel along the catapult, over the shuttle, you can feel it go like that, and then the brakes on. They are now going to attach the bridle to the aeroplane. The bridle goes around the shuttle, which is on the catapult, and goes into the leading, close inboard on the leading edges of the wing beneath, and then they tighten that up, tension the catapult, and there you are. The nose leg you've extended, that is done from the ground in the port undercarriage bay. They extend the nose leg, there we go. Now, going back to what I said at Bedford, the incidence required for the stabilator has been determined according to the end speed at the catapult, more of which the waist catapult would actually give an end speed of 118 knots. That's it in 195 feet. Add to that the ship's speed and the natural wind, which generally, ideally, should be about 30 knots. So 148 knots is what you're going to be having is wind over the wings at the end of the cat shot. The stab angle is checked down the back end there on the painted marks on the side of the fuselage. And when that guy's satisfied, I'm satisfied because I can see the stab angle here as well in a little gauge. We're all hot to trot. The flight deck officer, who's wearing a white jacket, is waving this, which means wind up your power. So we're winding up, rocket out into reheat, everything's stabilized. Once it's all looking hot to trot like that, I accept the launch. He acknowledges I've got it, turns around, he looks up at flying control and gets the green light from there. They're happy that everything else is clear. Ahead of the aircraft carrier is clear, everything okay to launch. So he puts his flag on the deck. The guy who's going to fire the catapult, remember this is the chap who's got his hands on his head in the howdah, he fires the catapult. Now at this point, about half a ton of superheated steam goes into the catapult. And I think it's about 600 degrees, this steam. I mean, it's a considerable thing. And bang, you go. 2.5 seconds on the catapult and off you go. It's a vibrating, exhilarating time because your head's right back against the seat like that. and this sort of stuff, and then all of a sudden it's over 2.5 seconds later and you're free to fly. Disconnect the SPD, you're at full flap, start bringing the flap in ahead. Remember that, don't overstress the undercarriage, don't overstress the flap. That sort of shit all comes fairly naturally. And the nose leg, 40 inches of extension, automatically the 40 inches goes back in and the gear comes up in sequence. Well, it should do. On occasion it didn't, and people had to go ashore with a 40-inch extension, in the aeroplane, that is. Enough of that. So there I am. I'm now airborne and join up with the other two aircraft, probably, and off we go to play bat and ball in the skies. And I'm not really paying much attention to that because my bit's coming up at the end of the 1 hour doing that. Back to the carrier. Now, first time on for me. Land isn't far away. This is Lime Bay, and they must know that if I screw it up, there's an airfield close by I can go to, in this case, Yeovilton. So back to the carrier, and we join the wait, as it's called, for our turn. That's a holding pattern, the wait. And then we're cleared to slot. Slotting is a run-in and brake, but it's done at 270 knots, not 420, 450, or any other exciting thing that people ashore in the Air Force might expect. Break into the circuit, 10 seconds between aircraft, and as soon as you're downwind, speed's reducing, you get gear down, full flap, and you hold that speed and that configuration until the time you have finished the landing. So downwind, it's a nice day for me, there's the carrier, aiming for 1.25 miles of beam, and as you pass a beam, you start the turn. Around you go, about 140 knots, something like that. And eventually, you'll come into the straightway, where the aircraft carrier is right ahead of you, and you call on site. You're looking at the deck projector landing site, and there it is, there's the ball, and hopefully the green ball is in the middle of the horizontal datum, showing that the glide path is right. Other things, of course, are lineup and airspeed. Now, there's a lot of help back in those days on the aircraft. For starters, you look in the gauge here, there's someone in the back seat can speak to you saying you're 5 knots fast, you're 10 knots slow, that sort of stuff. There's also audio angle of attack. If you're fast, it's going beep, 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 beep. If you're slow, it's boop, boop, boop. And if you're right, it's boop. I once heard that. Anyway, the additional bit is the landing safety officer. Remember the bloke with the big moustache here saying, rudder, slightly high, low power. All that sort of stuff, like that, as you're coming in. There's a lot of things looking after you, and not least self-preservation. In you get, holding a steady attitude, steady rate of descent as best you can, and there's no flaring, you're going straight into the deck, bang, down you go, 700 to 800 feet a minute. That's it. And that's a roller. That's my first approach to the deck, which had been commented on by the landing safety officer, the bloke in the back twittering away and breathing very heavily. Round for another one. Can it get worse? Well, yes, I suppose it can. Anyway, that next one, not wonderful. Third time, hook down. The ship tells me, hook down. That means I'm hooked down here, I think it was. And I'm going to hook on the aircraft carrier. There are four wires, 8 feet apart. The target wire for the Phantom was 3. So miss one, miss two, aiming for 3. That gave sufficient clearance over the back end. That's the reason it was the third. Buccaneer was a bit further back because it was flat aeroplane. And so for me, I hit the deck, 700 to 800 feet a minute, taxied quite a long way forward and caught number one wire. So there's a lot of twittering from the landing safety officer. Who gives a shit? I'm down anyway. So having rested on the wire, hook up, wings folded, taxi forward, marshal is everywhere, marshalling you to the front, what's called Fly One, a crowded area by the end of the day sort of thing, and we were not responsible for the clearances of the aircraft from the pilot's point of view. The marshallers were. Do it slowly, there you are, and then shut down the engines. The aircraft has been lashed down with minimum lashings, and out you get, sort of knee trembling out of the aeroplane. Quick fag as soon as they get into the island superstructure. Okay, that's the first sortie over. The next thing that happens on every single carrier landing is the assessment from the landing safety officer or his deputy. Each squadron provided a deputy. And mine was assessed of the four colours you can get, blue for an ace approach, almost no corrections made whatsoever, it was steady, green for a pretty good approach, yellow for rather workmanlike, and red, which I got that day, for it was quite bloody dangerous because it got low with no corrections on, and not that dangerous, but we walked away. So that was it, and everyone's there to hear how badly you did, those who haven't seen it, because imagine to yourself how many people as spectators will be around the island superstructure to watch someone doing it for the first time. I mean, there was a television program called Sailing, I think it was, where one of the Air Force Buccaneer pilots gave the deck a whole thrill and eventually got sent ashore after six or seven approaches to the deck. The more you do it, the more you're going to get heated up. So ideally, no more than three approaches, two rollers and hook on for practice. In the future, on ordinary flying days, you don't bother with these rollers. The deck, they want the deck ready for the next departures, etc. So you hook on straight away. The actual ship itself is quite a slick operation, and its purpose, I'm sure everyone's aware of, was well illustrated. 1972 Guatemala, where the Guatemalans decided to have an invasion of Belize. The Ark Royal wasn't far away, so the government can say, is there an aircraft carrier nearby? Yes, there is. Okay, do something about it. In this case, launch buccaneers off, refueled by buccaneer tankers to go down, show the flag, and frighten off the Guatemalans. That's the purpose of it. It is a point where British force can be projected wherever it's wanted, as long as it's in international waters, no one can stop it. There it is, with its escorts, etc., etc., etc. That's its purpose. In the island superstructure, there's an operations room, which is almost exactly the same as other services have. That's the ops room for what's going on. The captain's day cabin, the captain's bridge, the flying flyco, etc., and air traffic. Air traffic control for the normal things, visual circuits, carrier controlled approaches, which is a radar letdown, etc. That's it. No ILSs in those days. And fighter controllers called Ds, directors. That sums up the ship's operation there. 2,700 people on board this ship, of whom about 1,000, maybe slightly more, are the air group. The air group comprised, in my time, 12 Phantoms, 14 Buccaneers, 6 Sea Kings, 4 Gannets, and 3 Wessex. The Wessex were plain guard, and also were used for doing replenishment between ships, vertical replenishment on occasion. Always our friend. Every time we took off or landed, the plane guard helicopter was out on the port side there. Had anything gone wrong, there's a diver in the door there and they're ready to jump in and do the necessary. Off the bow catapult, for example, if the aircraft goes in, the ship is going to run over the aircraft. It has to wait to sink, but the diver would go down. I never saw that sort of thing happen, except on film when they were trying to frighten me successfully. Our accommodation. The 1,000 or so of the air group didn't get the best accommodation. Guess what? The ship's crew, the ship's company, had all that. When I joined, I had a room with zero view, 7 deck, which is 3 decks below the waterline. And there were 4 of us in there, the 4 junior Joes. Not much to be said about it. It's bunk beds, your own bunk beds above your writing desk and chest of drawers where all your own possessions can go. A place to write a letter, read a book, have a sleep, because it's below the waterline, switch the lights off, it's pitch black. And there are lots of noises to lull you to sleep. The shafts of the ship turning at whatever rate, depending on the ship's speed, air conditioning, all sorts of noises, water flowing through, etc., etc. When you're not flying or sleeping, well, there's a bit of eating at the ACRB, sometimes drinking in the wardroom bar. The wardroom is about 5 deck, as I recall, just below the waterline, a big bar and a popular spot. The wardroom bar, wardroom dining room, we would meet up by general agreement, 6 o'clock every evening, if we were eating early. The wardroom dining room was small, not big enough for 2 big squadrons. So we made an agreement with the Bucks. We would alternate whether we ate early or ate late. So into the bar at 6 o'clock, And there were a couple of little gambling games we used to play, horsing and spoofing. I'm trying to remember which is which. But the horsing one was who's buying wine, etc. So we'd go around various numbers, etc., three coins in your hand, until someone was actually forced to say the number of coins that there were within the group. They would buy wine for the meal. Now, this isn't a desperate situation. It can be as cheap as 10p, the old p, for a bottle, especially if you've been to Malta. On the drinking, it was fairly heavily policed, in as much as the commander, the executive officer of the ship, liked to keep an eye on what we were up to. There was a limit of £20 a month, 66p a day. Now, as my boss said, this is a limit, not a target. The drinking at 66p a day, if you were keen, you could have 22 measures of vodka. Not many did, but if you were a beer drinker, and many were, 5.5 pints. Now that was Courage Export, was the draft beer, and that was strong stuff, and it was plenty for anyone. Not normally a problem. The drinking wasn't excessive during the flying week. The week, by the way, was a 10-day week, 9 days of flying and a day of maintenance on the 10th day. So the night, the ninth day, you could really take the top off the bottle and have a go at it, and knowing that the worst thing that's going to happen the next day is you're going to have to sit through boring lectures in the squadron ready room at a thing called shareholders. Shareholders is a Navy expression for all aircrew meeting, and the QFI says his bit, the air weapons instructor says his bit, this sort of stuff. Notices come out from the executive officer, blah, 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 blah. But the £20 thing was watched closely, because if you had expensive liqueurs, you could really wind it up a bit. So I got one of the RAF navigators' wine bill, because we just sign for things like that, and I use his. Well, one night I must have lost my judgment slightly, because he got a warning for his excessive drinking, and he was teetotal. But there we go.
So how long were you based on the ship for, like, time period wise?
Generally, it was 6 months at a time, and a 6 month deployment would be out of embarking the aeroplanes, probably in Lime Bay, because it's most of the way there. Gibraltar on the way out for whatever reason. It could be going around the Med, so Malta would be a popular spot to go, Toulouse or something like that. Toulon, sorry, not Toulouse. Barcelona, or transatlantic. So perhaps 4 days crossing to the Caribbean, exercising with US Navy a lot. The ship would require a little bit of maintenance, so this was achieved by disembarking the air group to various naval air stations to carry on flying with the host squadrons, whilst the ship had the barnacles scraped, this sort of thing. Then we'd re-embark 3 weeks later, and off we'd go again. When not embarked on the ship, the squadron was based at Lucas and would be assigned to strike command for air defence duties. We could do things like Q. Gosh, how we all liked Q. One of my bosses was a charming gent, still see him at reunions, and he said, if we're going to have to sit in these smelly rubber suits, we might as well enjoy our meal. So there'd be wine with the meal, which the Air Force would have frowned on. No, not vast quantities, you'd have a glass, something like that. Didn't do an awful lot of Q, never got called out myself. Whilst ashore, we did detachments in NATO, so we could go to Germany or Norway or wherever, which is really rather fun. And we could, on occasion, borrow aeroplanes, free, gratis, and for nothing. But it would be to justify something, a cross-country navigation exercise, high-level transit to Germany and Ramstein or something like that. Not common, but pleasant enough, you know. Made the life quite nice and varied. Meantime, Lucas Base, there are lots of worse places to be. Golf, whatever, sailing. Enjoyable, I like living in Scotland. There were differences in the way the Air Force and the Navy did air intercepts, etc., and both sides did it the right way, as they would be the first to tell you. So we trained most of the time air defence stuff when we were ashore with the RAF or even at sea, but interspersed it with low-level flying and ground attack, or sea attack. The Navy had its own way of making sea attacks, type Alpha, Bravo, and Charlie, depending on what you were going to deliver. Some of them were totally impractical, that there aren't many features when you're flying over the sea in which to pull up on this bit and navigate in this bit. It's all flat and wet. The aircraft carrier would tow a splash target about 500 yards astern of the ship. The ship, as long as it's got 12 or 15 knots on, this thing is a big wake kicked up, and we'd make our attacks with rockets or bombs onto the splash target. Ashore, as I said earlier on from the PTF, we'd use Rose Hearty, Wayne Fleet, and Tain Rangers for the weapons. I mentioned napalm tanks earlier on. On one trip I did, this is with the Navy, an aircraft required an engine air test. So off I went, standard aeroplane, two tanks fitted, pylons, etc. Did the air test, which is climbing to 40,000 feet, or thereabouts as I recall, slam tests down, lots of fuel left. So we did a leisurely sightseeing thing down the Western Isles, and then low level in the west, and as I was flying up a valley, Glen Tay, there was a quite low and quite fast, there was a big bang. And that was it, just a big bang. No telly light captions or anything came on, but something had clearly happened. Anyway, pulled up, slow speed handling check on the way back to Lucas, landed at Lucas, and as I taxied in, some of the sailors were going like that. So in reality, what had happened is a loom, an electrical loom within the aircraft had frayed and had fired all the explosive release units, so the pylons, the tanks, the whole nine yards, the dummy missiles, all came off very close to the Tin Drum Hotel. Anyway, it didn't get 15 minutes of fame for me, but it was a few minutes on the national news that night. Yeah, I remember that one because, of course, I was to blame for it until such time as they ran the bolts around, and quite clearly I hadn't pressed the clear wing bar. I mentioned that we would be on occasion in company with another carrier, a US carrier, and if it was necessary, this could be used as a diversion, and that's a two-way street. So cross-decking, as it was known, was not uncommon. It wasn't done intentionally, but if one deck was foul and there wasn't tanker support available, you could go and land on the other one. Our systems were compatible. The only difference with our Phantoms versus their Phantoms, these being the predominant aeroplanes at the time, was that ours with the extended nose leg pointed the jet pipes right down on the deck. And in burner, before going off the catapult, it made their decks very hot. They had a longer catapult stroke, about 300 feet off four catapults. So it was a gentler process. Ours, we used jet blast deflectors, which were water cooled on the ship. A popular cross-decking in as much as if you got over to the Americans, and I never got one of those, the popular bit to get was a US Navy flying jacket, you know, the leather jacket. The more badges, the better, of course, particularly in bars ashore. And from their point of view, what we had going, they didn't, was a bar. If they could stay overnight, they could fill their boots and get a submariner's sweater. Now, those apparently were in high demand in the US. So that was about it with those. Flying with the American carriers, we could do unlike combat training against, they had E6s, A6s, A7s, and of course their Phantoms, which is quite fun to mix it up. Generally, if we were going to do that sort of thing, they'd send someone to our ship or vice versa so that a proper briefing took place, everyone knew where to meet, what to do, etc., etc. So it wasn't just a free-for-all. And it just relatively controlled by ops rooms, air defense, air direction rooms, etc. Discipline could be sometimes stretched flying past other people's ships. Well, I wouldn't care to do it against a US Navy ship because they could be quite humorless. But we were frequently, in fact, almost invariably shadowed by an AGI, an auxiliary gatherer of intelligence, Russian, looks like a trawler. So, giving them a fly past, pushing Mach 1 would deafen them a bit and close and open watertight shutters a little bit. Illegal, but everyone turned a blind eye to that sort of indiscipline. Flying past our own ship, yes, frequently, and on occasion we would be doing things called QUATs, which is a quality assessment of weapons type systems. For example, one of the guys got airborne with 13 540 pounders, which is a big load. The idea for test purposes, the weapons people were on board, was to drop these alongside the ship, not very close, but aiming for a mile off the ship, etc. Simultaneous release of 13 540 pounders. Well, on that day, they didn't come off at all. So it got hung up aeroplane with all these bombs on, and these are high explosive bombs. The decision was made to bring the aircraft back on board the carrier. To this end, no human beings were on the flight deck, minimal manning in the island superstructure, and I think two deck was cleared, as I can recall being in four deck at the time. That was it. The aircraft came back on, landed uneventfully. Not even a bomb fell off. Now that was, the QWOT team had a lot to look at because it was their problem. They'd, anyway, that was just an example of a weapons type thing. One that was always spectacular for the ground crew on and off, the off-duty ground crew people, a Buccaneer tossing a Leapers flare, which is the thing I mentioned in ground attack from my 6th Squadron days, and then a Phantom firing a sidewinder at it, ahead of the ship, but it looks very spectacular, because you can see this thing on a parachute, a bright light, and then the plume of a sidewinder missile going off and knocking the Leapers flare. Rare things, but for people who've been stuck in dark holes sometimes, watching what the air crew do is a good plus. Generally in company with us, there would be two fleet auxiliaries. The oiler, which I mentioned when I first joined the ship, for the starboard side, that carried furnace fuel oil, water, and aviation fuel. The carrier, Ark Royal, carried about 6,000 tons of furnace fuel oil, and they tried to keep it all the time at least 70%. So if anything went wrong, the ship had probably 10 days of sailing or something like that. And 1,500 to 1,600 tons of aviation fuel would be available. Sounds a lot, but it isn't actually, because every time we got airborne, we had seven or eight tons minimum of fuel. And we were doing three or four waves of flying every day. People ask them, did you do a lot of flying? Well, the answer is no, not an awful lot. Probably a good month would be 20 hours flying in the month, but all high pressure stuff at the time, all good fun, etc.
Was there any night flying?
Yes, there was night flying. There was a designated night team, which was four or five people. These are the ones with grey hair and a nervous twitch. But the night flying team, the restrictions were, the Navy made it difficult, the Royal Navy made night flying a big drama in itself, in as much as the US Navy, the majority shareholder in this aviation game of at sea, what they would do is train everyone who finished their flying training, they would do carrier qualification, car qual. That was 6 day landings, 5 night traps, all in a period of about 24 hours. So that was it, no drama. Whereas the Royal Navy, it took years before you'd be trusted, the aircraft were available, etc., for the night team. Further, you could not night fly unless you'd flown the previous night or that day. So it was highly restrictive. Also, getting back on board came off a carrier-controlled approach. This is a GCA, as the other services would call it, to come back on board at night. The visual cues on the deck were very limited. Along the center line, there were about 10 lights, and then down the back of the ship, there were 3 lights called the Donkey's Plonker. And if those lights you saw at an angle, so that's the center line, and you saw them that thing, it meant fly that way to regain your center line, etc. So you're being talked down, and then your late stage LSO picks you up, or you pick up the sight, you call on sight, that's it, straight on in. And I never saw a happy person step out of an aeroplane, particularly unhappy walking out, but coming back in nervous and the cigarettes. And always, regardless of whether the bar was still open or not, there would be booze available for the guys. Yeah, so here I am looking back at all this stuff, some of it like it was yesterday. And it's 40 years, 50 years, some of this stuff. So did I enjoy it all? Yes, but I mean, we all remember the sunny days, etc. Don't remember the days of being in deep shit and getting extra orderly officers or officer of the watch, officer of the day, all that sort of stuff. The Navy was a fantastic experience, and it's the only reunion I go to, and it's a thing called the Gash Hands Reunion, not a particular squadron one, but it's people of my era with the Fleet Air Arm of the varying type, Buccaneers, Gannets, and Phantoms. And we catch up, tell each other. But, you know, it's one of those cliches. The older we get, the better we were. So I did just under 15 years total time, man and boy, in which time I only got 3,000 hours. Didn't pick up hours very high rate flying the fighter type aircraft. Recently I was flying 600 hours a year, 700 hours a year on long range stuff. But a lot of that is, of course, spent in a bunker watching a movie. So that's what's changed. Would I change any of it? Some, I guess I would. You know, we all learn by our mistakes, but it's too fucking late now. So I've made my bed and I lie in it.
So Chris, do you have any hobbies?
Well, as the flying, we're just about to go and get in that little aeroplane there. So here in Portugal, I fly that. The thing there is a Cessna 172 with variable prop, quite fun. Plus of that aircraft, which you were just about to be in, is it's got a high wing. Summer here is hot. If you've got a low wing bubble canopy, you don't half get hot. There's no air conditioning in those except open a window. Other hobbies, well, we have some little apartments we look after, my wife and myself. Travel, we recently joined a hotel group thing which gives us fantastic opportunities to go on holidays, especially in Portugal and its dependencies like Cape Verde Islands, Madeira, etc., Azores. Spare time, I try and keep less unfit, so I'm doing about 5 miles just walking per day and at least half an hour swimming. Those are things. Eating out, the cafe society, the beautiful people. Of course, these are all a part of my life, but nothing's changed there. That about sums up my life here. We enjoy it. We've been here just coming up for 6 years, having spent a lot of time overseas. I was in my airline environment. I was in Vietnam, a couple of years there, Singapore, Sri Lanka, India, and other European countries. Yeah, so not bad looking back on it. And I'm still flying. That's the plus.
Do you have a favorite aircraft?
I can't say I really do have a favorite aircraft. When I'm in UK, I'm going next week, I do tail dragging. There's a friend of mine owns a thing called an RV7, which is side by side and is not dissimilar to the little airplane you see there. That's an RV6. So his idea, he's an old colleague of mine from Navy days, sorry, Air Force days. We just get in the airplane in the morning, fly somewhere for coffee, on somewhere else, have a lunch, on somewhere else, afternoon tea, then back in, based in Henlo and Witten. So it gets me tailwheel landing experience again, because this is all simple stuff. Except for that aeroplane, if you look over there, he's the one who landed without any wheels and his propellers are all bent up. You'll see it as we walk out to the aeroplane. No actual hobbies and never short of things to do. Fairly good life out here. I would recommend it to anyone. If you're thinking of being an expat, the country next door is not quite as good. They're not so pro-British. Here, English is almost universally spoken, here being the Algarve, and they're really friendly folk. Nice place.
And finally, do you ever get sick of talking about aviation?
I don't, as it happens, but other people show their disdain for my one topic of conversation.